Good morning. We've come to worship the Lord. So I want each person here to participate. I want you to pray. I want you to sing, clap, shout. Whatever the Spirit of God is saying to you, do it. But most of all, I want you to focus on what the Word of God is going to say to you today. Our pastor, Reverend Dr. Philip Stubbs, will be bringing a message to us. And so I'd like to welcome you on behalf of himself and his wife and all the members and officers here at St. Michael's Methodist Church. We are a church where our desire is to know God just a little bit deeper. And so, as Rev brings the word today, he's going to remind us that our children are gifts from God and that each one has a sacredness about them. And so his topic is, each child, a sacred trust. And while I was thinking about children, I remember a poem. I'll just read a part of it from Cahil Gibran's. This is what he said about children. Your children are not your children. They are the sons and daughters of life's longing for itself. They come through you, but not from you. And though they are with you, yet they belong not to you. You may give them your love, but not your thoughts, for they have their own thoughts. You may house their bodies, but not their souls, for their souls dwell in the house of tomorrow, which you cannot visit, not even in your dreams. You may strive to be like them, but seek not to make them like you. For life goes not backward, nor tarries with yesterday. You are the bows from which your children, as living arrows, are sent forth. You are the bows from which your children, as living arrows, sent forth. And the Word of God itself reminds us that we as parents and as adults must realize that children are very special. And Jesus himself reminded his disciples when he was here on earth, walking among us, he demonstrated the importance of allowing children to come to him. And he told his disciples that in order to be a part of his kingdom, they must become as little children. And so as we worship this God, our God, who is able to do transformation of our hearts and our minds and has given us sacred gifts, we are going to sing our opening hymn. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem to crown him Lord of all. And we are going to sing verse 1, 3, 5, and 6. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Please stand with us.
Lord, Lord,
Father, we bless you this morning for the vision that one day we are going to join in the everlasting song. And we are going to crown Jesus Lord of all. Hallelujah. God, we bless you this morning that because of the work Jesus did on Calvary, we can come boldly into your throne room this morning and look with expectancy to that coronation day. Father, we bless you for all that you've done for us and all that you're doing right now and all that you will do in the future. We know that every good and every perfect gift are gifts from your hand. And so we bless you and we say thank you for your marvelous grace and mercy which you pour out on us on a daily basis. And so we pause to say thank you for your new blessings today, morning by morning. New mercies we experience all because of your love and your greatness. And so as your people gather in this place this morning, we come with hearts of thanksgiving, giving you praise in advance that you are going to speak to each one of us from your word through your manservant. And God, we thank you that whatever you hear your spirit saying to him this morning, he will declare it with power and with might. And we praise you that your word will go forth with anointing. And so every yoke that came through that door this morning will be broken and destroyed in the name of Jesus. We say, be glorified in this place this morning. Let our praises come up to your throne room as sweet-smelling incense. And we bless you because we know that you inhabit the praises of your people. And thank you that where you are, the blessings will flow. Be honored and be glorified in everything that is done in this place this morning. Because we believe what you've said in your word will be fulfilled. Because you are that kind of God. A promise keeper. A God who does not renege on his promises. And so we bless you with all that is within us this morning. Because you are the only worthy one. In the name of Jesus, we give you thanks in advance. Amen. And amen. And amen.
Thank you.
God, we believe for it. The God who can move the immovable, break the unbreakable. That's the kind of God who we serve. Amen?
Amen.
Anybody had any immovables moved out of their lives? Any unbreakables destroyed? That's our God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now we are going to repeat our memory verse for this month, which comes from the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 19, and we will repeat it twice. Join me. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 19a. God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 19a. One more time. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 19a. God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 19a. And now you'll be led in praise and worship. Your time to participate.
Good morning again. We invite you to stand. And like we just declared in that song, move the immovable, move the unbreakable. And if you believe, tell your neighbor, I believe. Tell your neighbor, I believe. He's standing on faith today, say, I believe. You got your opportunity to tell the Lord, no, you believe.
I trust in you, oh Lord, Jehovah, you.
I trust
in you.
I believe, I believe, I believe.
I trust
in you,
oh Lord, Jehovah, you.
I trust
in you.
I believe, I believe you are the God of miracles.
You are the God.
You are the God of wonders. You are the God.
All powerful.
I believe, I believe, I believe.
Jehovah,
I trust
in you,
oh Lord, Jehovah,
I trust
in you,
I believe, I believe in you,
I trust
in you,
you
are the God
of miracles.
You are the God.
You are the God
of wonders.
Oh, you are the God.
You are the God of powerful.
I believe, I believe, I believe,
I believe, I believe.
So long.
Goodbye to the sickness.
Bye-bye.
Goodbye to the suffering.
Bye-bye.
Goodbye to the pressure. depression.
Bye-bye.
Goodbye to the pressure.
Bye-bye.
Goodbye to the cancer.
Bye-bye.
Goodbye to the pain.
Bye-bye.
Goodbye to the suffering.
Bye-bye.
Goodbye to the pressure.
Bye-bye.
You are
the God of miracles.
Shake and the hills move beneath you. That's when everything's falling apart. God says that his love will remain and his covenant of peace will remain with you. So if you're in a place where things shaking, you got some bad news, your job, your family, your body not cooperating, it feels like everything underneath you is moving. Today we declare in this place that he'll be your strength.
Yes.
Amen. He will be your strength. He will be your peace. He will be your joy. And so we declare in this place that he is our strength. And it says, the word says, when we are weak, he is
strong.
Amen. Amen. So we can stand and declare.
Oh.
the blood.
Methodist Church family on this blessed Sunday. What a beautiful morning it is. We want to, as a part of our worship, acknowledge and honor one of our members received this month as a part of the national honors. We are so thankful for her legacy. She has become an icon amongst clergy persons and amongst the body of Christ and the Methodist Communion and the nation. Recognized that this month as she was honored with the designation the Most Honorable Reverend Kenrith Carey. We invite her to celebrate. Amen. A most fitting honor. We celebrate you, Sister Ken, and your ministry, your legacy, and persons who are decades younger than her have difficulty keeping up with her still. She gets in her car and she's on the move. On the move, we are thankful for you. And we celebrate you and the others who were honored during the National Honors Week. We come now to bring our tithes and our offering to the house of God, for the work of God at this time. We have a wonderful offertory, and I'm going to ask if we really invest in it as the tithes and offering are received, and as we bring our food basket gifts to the food basket here at the altar. Friends, each week we have persons who come to the church for spiritual sustenance, for emotional support, and for food, for material assistance. Through the food basket ministry, we support those persons in the name of Christ, and we're able to do that when we have the funds in place. And so we sing, "Give thanks with a grateful heart," as we bring our gifts to the house of God for the work of God.
Father, we give you thanks for your manifold blessings on each one of us. Thank you for these tithes and offering that have been received. And God, we thank you that you will open up the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing on those persons who have given, because that is your promise. In Jesus' name, amen. Our Old Testament reading comes from the book of 1 Samuel, chapter 1, verses 21 through 28, and that will be done by Alonzo Cunningham. The gospel reading comes from the book of Luke, chapter 2, verses 22 through 32, and Teresa Fraser will read the gospel for us.
Good morning, church. The word of God will be taken from 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 21 through 28. Now the man of Elkanah and all his house went up to offer to the Lord the yearly sacrifice and his vow. But Hannah did not go up, for she said to her husband, "Not until the child is weaned, then I will take him, that he may appear before the Lord and remain there forever." So Elkanah, her husband, said to her, "Do what seems best to you. Wait until you have weaned him. Only let the Lord establish his word." Then the woman stayed and nursed her son until she had weaned him. Now, when she had weaned him, she took him up with her, with three bolts, one ephah of flour, and a skin of wine, and brought him to the house of the Lord in Shiloh. And the child was young. Then they slaughtered a bull and brought the child to Eli. And she said, "Oh, my Lord, as your soul lives, my Lord, I am the woman who stood by you here praying to the Lord. For this child I prayed, and the Lord has granted me my petition, which I asked of him. Therefore, I also have lent him to the Lord. As long as he lives, he shall be lent to the Lord." So they worship the Lord there. The word of God.
The scripture lesson is taken from Luke chapter 2, verses 22 through 32. Now when the days of her purification, according to the law of Moses, were completed, they brought him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord, as it is written in the law of the Lord, "Every male who opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons." And behold, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. And this man was just and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel. And the Holy Spirit was upon him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. So he came by the Spirit into the temple. And when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him according to the custom of the law, he took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, "Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared before the face of all peoples, a light to bring revelation to the Gentiles, and the glory of your people, Israel." Here ends the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Praise Christ, our Lord.
Kindly be seated. We give God thanks for this day and for this moment of sharing God's word. Let's bow our heads together for a word of prayer. Gracious God, we are before your presence in worship. We pray that all of us might lean into your spirit so that we might grow in our relationship with you. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. O God, our strength, our rock, our redeemer, we pray. Amen. Amen. We thank God for this day, for the baptisms that are before us and that will follow the sermon this morning. Jatario and Zion, who come brought by their parents on this day. And we reflect on a word that relates to all of us, because no matter what our age, we started as infants. It might be a stretch of the imagination for those of us who are in our later decades to think about us beginning as infants, but we started as infants. Really, Holy Scripture tells us that we all come from the source of life, God Himself. We see this in the creation story, and I begin with that. There was a time before creation when there was no time, and God Himself existed. And God determined that God would bring about this world. And God fashioned this world out of chaos, out of nothing. And the story is before us at the very beginning chapters in Genesis, where God alone, an uncreated being, did what God alone could do. God brought out of chaos, God brought out of nothing this wonderful creation, and we know that it is a wonderful creation because God said, "This is good." And I'm looking at the creation story. God spends primary time, the longest time, the most investment in the human being. God said to the human person himself, "Only you I'm creating in my image. I'm creating you in my image." And so for every one of us, our parents, our trustees, we come through our parents. The image of God, the imagio Deo, is in every one of us. A piece of God is in you and in me. And so the imprint of God is over all creation. And the sages tell us very plainly, very plainly. And we would do well to reflect on this. The sages tell us very plainly, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, and all of those who dwell therein. It pays to meditate upon that. God alone is creator. We did not create ourselves. God alone is owner. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, and all of us who dwell therein. And so God, the source of life, gives life to the human being, and God in his design results in being is the source through which infant after infant comes into this world. And parents are entrusted with children. And so on this day, as we baptize those who've come to the house of God, we are reminded that each child is a sacred trust. Each child. For Jatario and Zion who come today, we are thankful. But maybe we be reminded that each child in our family circle, indeed, may I say this to all of us, we are a sacred trust one to another. And we have in Holy Scripture models as to how we are to handle each other. And in the Old Testament reading and in the Gospel reading, We have several lessons from Hannah and from Joseph and Mary as to how one is to handle a child entrusted to parents, to family. God gives us wonderful children. This was the case for Hannah. This was the case for Mary and Joseph. And you see their first move. Hannah takes her child, first of all, to the house of God. Mary and Joseph do the same. They submit themselves to the Jewish protocol, and they take Jesus to be dedicated, and Hannah takes Samuel to be dedicated. And they give us a guide as to how to be persons who manage the sacred trust that each child is. First and foremost, to acknowledge that the child comes from God. And at the earliest possible time, to take the child to the house of God and to lift the child up and say to God, "You are the source of life. This child would not be here if it was not for you. I dedicate as mom and as dad this child to you." That's the best way to do it. And for all adults who are present, who have been formed and framed by parents who took you to the house of God in the beginning months of your life, give thanks for them. Parents who had an understanding that this is a sacred trust, that every life comes from God, and that we are with reverence to make our way to the house of God and to say to God, "This life has come from you. You are Creator God. I am not." And to dedicate that child to you, to God Almighty. And so to manage the trust well, sisters and brothers, is to seen in bringing the child to the house of God. We see Mary and Joseph entrusted with the Son of God, hear me now, submitting themselves to the protocol of God's people. And they make their way to the house of God. And the baby is dedicated. May we appreciate that this beginning with the child has the best integrity. When the child is brought to the house of God, all the days of his life or her life, when the dedication as infant is a beginning. We see this in Hannah. We see this in Jesus and Joseph and Mary. And so the dedication happens in the house of God, and then there is the daily formation, first of Samuel and then of Jesus. The dedication in the house of God, and then the daily formation. The word of God says Jesus grew in favor with God and man. And we see Samuel growing as a young man in the temple, and we see Hannah close by, observing his growth, being a part of his growth, and then witnessing his service to the house of Israel. And so first the dedication in the house of God, and then every step of maturation as the infant becomes a child, as the child becomes an adolescent, as the adolescent becomes a teenager, as the teenager becomes a young adult, God is present every step of the way, and parents who manage the trust well, they invest in the spiritual, mental, social development of the child every step of the way. We see this happening when children learn not just about Disney World, but about Jerusalem. We see this happening when children learn not just the latest game to play, but they understand what the psalmist says, teach me to number my days so that I might gain a heart of wisdom. And so parents, bringing children to worship today, and parents one and all, first there is the dedication. And one cannot help but be impressed with Hannah. She prayed for that child. And then she gave God thanks for the child. Sometimes people forget where their blessings come from. But Hannah made her way to the house of God. Don't worry, Zion is fine. That's just him practicing for a wonderful Methodist choir that he's going to be a part of. Alto, I think it is. Or baritone, we'll see. So first, dedication of the child. And then daily formation of the child. And then the child's destiny. Samuel was guided by his parents. Joseph had the wonderful guidance of Mary and Joseph. The Holy Scripture supports that they did well with their parenting. They did not obstruct his movement into his destiny. There's a word from the book of Proverbs about training a child. Train up a child in the way that he shall go. And when he is old, he will not depart from it. That has to do with guidance, that has to do with instruction. But there is another layer that is often missed in that verse. Train up a child in the way that he, she should go. And when they are grown, they will not depart from it. A part of that scripture is this. Parents are to discover what is the temperament, what are the gifts of the child, and to find out what is latent in the gifts, how their destiny is a part of their gifts, and to provoke that gift, to grow that gift, to give every opportunity for that gift, so that the child might flourish using the gift. That's a part of that teaching. Yes, it's about moral guidance. Yes, it's about spiritual boundaries. But it is also about the parent. The parents discovering what God Almighty has put into the child. So that the child might have every opportunity to develop that gift. So that the parents might put the child in situations where that gift might be provoked. That gift might be developed. And the child might live out the destiny that is grounded in that gift. And so every child is indeed a sacred trust. We're called to manage them. We're called to appreciate that one day we will have to give an account as parents. The most influential agent in the life of a child is the parent. The most influential place in the life of the child is the home. And we need to reinforce that. That not only legally, but spiritually, parents are responsible for bringing their child up in a way that brings delight to the heart of God. That enriches not only their child's life, but enriches society. And in both readings today, we see the example. Mary and Joseph and Hannah, they submit themselves to the protocols of the day, and they take their child to the house of God. First, the dedication. And then the daily discipline of teaching the child about God and about how to live with people and how to develop their gifts, the daily formation, that wonderful summary of our Lord's development. He grew in favor with God and man. And then the destiny. Samuel is the final priest in the house of Israel, and he is the first prophet. That was his destiny. That was his destiny. And he was born to a woman who was ridiculed and looked down upon and seen as a barren woman cursed by God. God loves to take what people curse and bless. Somehow God has a penchant for it. He loves to take people out of the Nazareths of every generation. He loves to take the regular and the ordinary and make it extraordinary. Do something about it. They said Mary was Mary. Mary and Joseph, their neighbors wanted to cloister them in shadows, but the light of heaven would not allow the shadows to stick. God entrusted his son with this ordinary person. And this would be, as Simeon said, the consolation of Israel. This would be the one who would bring about the consummation of the journey of Israel by being the Redeemer, not only of Israel, but of the whole human family. Simeon was an older person, an elderly man. His eyes are dimmed, but he was born with a destiny. And even as this child, Jesus, as a child, was starting to live out his destiny, Simeon was there with the consummation of his destiny as an older person, as an elderly person. God had promised him, you will see the consolation of Israel. And when the child came into the temple, the Spirit of God said, that's the one. And Simeon lifted him up and blessed him. Whatever your age today, how are you doing with your destiny? How are you doing with the will of God? You have come from a God who has placed gifts in you, just as God has placed gifts in Zion and Zotario. You have come with a God who wants you to be dedicated to him. You have come with from a God, no matter what your age, who calls you to daily formation and then that destiny where you are living out the purposes that God has ordained for you to live out. We move to baptize those who are here for baptism, and we remind them and we remind all of us that each child is a sacred trust. But there is more. We remind each other that we are a sacred trust to each other. Husband to wife, parents to children, siblings one to another. That how we deal with each other reflects how we deal with God. That we are a sacred trust to each other. And so our behavior in word and thought and deed, we are called to be honorable in that behavior. And when we are dishonorable, we are called to seek forgiveness and move on and grow in our honor. How we treat one another reflects whether or not we are managing the trust well. This is why John, the elder statesman, says very plainly, do not say you love God whom you cannot see. If you do not love someone who you can see. And so to lift up full praises to a God whom you cannot see, and to not speak or to cut your eye at your neighbor who you can see, is dysfunctional and betrays the hollowness of a person's religion. We are a sacred trust to one another. This will never change because the sacred life of God is in each one of us. And so in thought, in word, and deed, we are called to be honorable in how we manage each other. Jesus was under duress. He was under pressure. And yet no guile was found in him because he didn't lash out. When we do lash out, may we be humble enough to seek forgiveness so that we can repair what's being hurt. Amen? And move on. Because we are a sacred trust, one to the other. Amen. Let's bow our heads together for a moment of reflection. May we remember that we all come from God. And in Jesus, God would claim us back as his children. How does this happen? By receiving Christ as Savior. That is why in this pulpit and all over the globe, thanks be to God, preachers will say to worshipers, do you know where you stand with Jesus? It will be said in different ways, but it will mean the same thing. Examine your connection with Jesus. He is our mediator. He is the one who links us to God. And so with heads bowed, this is not something extra we do in a Christian church. This is all that we are called to do. Examine where you are with Jesus. Is he your Savior? Have you asked him into your life? If you'd like to do that, here are words that you could use. They're Christ. Forgive me of my sins. Please come into my life. I receive you as my Savior. In your name I pray. Amen. Oh God, we are so thankful for your presence in this sacred place, for your word that's gone forth. Spirit of God, we thank you that you are attending to every mind, every life. May we follow your leading, Spirit of God, and appreciate that everyone in our life, each person, is a sacred trust, beginning with the children. And now, with reverence, we turn to this sacrament. Guide us, we pray, in this moment of worship. It is in the blessed name of Jesus the Christ that we pray, and the people of God said, amen. We turn to the baptism, and we invite parents to come with godparents to the center of the communion aisle. Be sure and bring your bulletin, and with grandparents who are present, kindly come, please. Sisters and brothers in Christ, the liturgy is in the bulletin, and I believe will be placed on the screen. We come now to share in Zion Adrian Bethel's baptism. We acknowledge and affirm that he is a gift from God, and that he is being brought by his parents to this place to be dedicated to God. And so we say to parents first, you come here to acknowledge that this, your child, belongs to God, to dedicate him to God in holy baptism, and to receive him again as from the hands of God, to be trained as a disciple of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And so to parents, I ask you therefore, will you endeavor, as far as in you lies, to provide a Christian home for this child, to bring him up in the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to surround him with such things as are pure and true, lovely and of good report? Will you endeavor so to order your own lives that no stumbling block be put in the way of this child? And to God, parents assembled here, will you support the spiritual, social, and material development of this child in and through the support of this child's parents? And now, to the congregation, beginning with the St. Michael's Methodist Church family, dearly beloved, who are of the household of faith through the high calling of God in Christ Jesus, and who are now in Christ's name to receive this child, will you endeavor so to maintain here a fellowship of worship and service in the church, that he may grow up in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord? Let us pray. Almighty and immortal God, the aid of all that need, the help of all that flee to you for sustenance, the life of them that believe, and the resurrection of the dead, we call upon you for this child, who we bring to you in this holy sacrament. Receive him, O Lord, as you have promised by your well-beloved Son, saying, ask and you shall have, seek and you shall find, knock and it shall be opened unto you. So give unto us that ask, let us that seek find. Open the gate unto us that knock, that this child may become and ever remain Christ's true disciple, and may at last attain to the eternal kingdom which you have promised by Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, whose blessed Son did share at Nazareth the life of an earthly home, bless, we beseech you, the home of this child, and grant wisdom and understanding to all who have him, the care of him, that he may grow up in your constant fear and love. Through the same your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray. Amen. O merciful God, our Heavenly Father, be pleased to give your Holy Spirit to the parents of this child, that they may have wisdom and grace to bring up their offspring in the nurture and admonition of the Lord and in the faith of your holy word. Through Jesus Christ, our only mediator and redeemer, we pray. Can we bring the chant? Let's pray, both of you. thank God for these beginning moments in Zion's life. I tell you, he looks like an old soul. And we pray that every blessing will attend to his journey. We're thankful for that godparents and grandparents and family members, one and all, are present here for this moment. And we are all reminded that dedication in these beginning months, and then daily formation at home, so that he might come to know Christ and enter into the destiny ordained by God. God bless you, one and all. Let's celebrate this beginning. We're thankful that this is the house of prayer, and that each week as we come together to share in prayer, to sustain one another, and to call upon God to hold us together. And so let's bow our heads together in this moment, please. Spirit of God, we would err if we don't begin with thanksgiving. Because you have, O God, answered all of our prayers. This past week and all of our lives, your love and mercy has been with us. And so we are thankful. We're thankful for your care. We're thankful for your presence. Lord, in this moment we affirm that you alone give us security. We witness yet again as we say that when the mountains fall into the sea and the earth is shaken, you, God, Lord Almighty, will hold us. When others turn away, yea, when mother and father are not able to help us, you, O God, will not forsake us. And so we're thankful. We come with thanksgiving that frames our focus, even as we pray for those celebrating birthdays and anniversaries. Bless each one, O God, we pray, celebrating. May each one choose to become a fully devoted disciple of Christ. Lord, we pray for this because you are life, and apart from you, there is no life. For those celebrating anniversaries and birthdays, bless with grace, with wisdom and good health, we pray. Oh Lord, we pray for members of our church family who are unwell and in need of healing. We think of Helen Marie in hospital, Ricardo Pez at home, Lilith Simonette at home, and Lord, others who are under travail. We believe that you are Jehovah Rapha, the Lord who heals, and that we are your people. We believe, O God, that you are God of care and a God of love. And we come in faith, yea, sometimes fumbling, but we come in faith, asking that you would heal the members of this church family, whose bodies, minds are in need of repair. Heal them, bring them to wholeness, touch them. Lord, we'll give you the glory. We'll give you the honor. We'll shout your praises. I pray for all of us that we might move into this week and appreciate that we have your image in us, And not only us, but every human person. And that we are called to live honorably with all persons. And so I pray for honor to be released in our actions today and this week, through our thoughts, through our words, through our deeds. May our speech be honorable, Lord, we pray. May we give evidence that we met you in worship today, that we received the word, and that we are living out the word. We pray for the journey of our church throughout this week. We pray that there might be an unction, an anointing amongst all who serve on behalf of this church as we go into these last months of this year. May there be a fullness of work for you in family life, in the life of the church, and a fullness of worship. We bless your name, even as we pray in Christ's name. Amen. We share now in the community notes lifted up for us in this moment.
We welcome you to St. Michael's today in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We are delighted that you are here. We have numerous exciting events happening in the life of our church. Here's what you need to know.
Join us for our virtual prayer meeting every Monday from 6 to 7 p.m. via Zoom. It is sure to be a time of rich prayer and praise for everyone. So join us Mondays at 6 for prayer meeting. Bible study will take place this Wednesday at 6:30 p.m. via Zoom as we continue our study on the Book of Acts. Our 60th anniversary celebrations are fast approaching, and we ask all to save the date, January 14th, 2024, as we prepare for a time of celebration. For St. Michael's 60th anniversary, we will be having a t-shirt design competition. Persons are asked to create a design for our anniversary t-shirt. Cash prizes will be awarded, and the theme is Together for His Glory. And the submission deadline is today, October 22nd. All entries are to be sent to the church office email or Mrs. Margaret Smith. So let's get our creative juices flowing and enter the competition today. Reverend Dr. Colin Archer will be having a book launch and signing on Friday, October 27th at 6 p.m. here at the church for his book, 12 Autonomy Stones. So we ask all members and friends to come out and support Reverend Dr. Colin Archer this Friday at 6 p.m. Congratulations goes out to the Most Honorable Reverend Kenris Carey, President Emerita, who led in the group of Methodists receiving honors during the National Heroes Investiture in October. We are so proud of you and congratulations. Directly following the service today, Arlington Hunter will be providing a culinary treat for his Harvest Seed Initiative. He will be selling stew conch and Johnny Cake for $10 and cassava bread for $2. So we ask all to support this initiative directly following the service today. Our 35th annual prayer conference under the theme, Prayer and the Prophetic, Make It Personal, will be held on November 3rd and 4th with various sessions and speakers throughout the day. So let us all be in place right here at the church for our annual prayer conference. Please note our upcoming events.
You are still showing up at the tomb of every Lazarus.
These are the announcements as I have them. Please remain abreast of the activities happening this week, and we wish all a safe and prosperous new week.
God has spoken to each of us. And Rev has reminded us that each of us are sacred trusts to each other. And what stood out with me, he said, if you lash out at someone, ask for forgiveness. Because I need you, and you need me. We are sacred trusts, gifts from the hand of God. So see yourself that way this week, and see the persons around you in the same light. Amen? Amen. And so we leave here singing the song, Children of Jerusalem. Sang the praise of Jesus' name. Children too of modern days join to sing the Savior's praise. Let's rise and sing to the honor and glory of God.
Thank God for our time of worship on this blessed Sunday. We thank our visitors and guests for being with us. We invite all to share with us in light refreshments in the Founders Vestry after the benediction. Remember, Arlington Hunter is expanding on his harvest seed with the sale of stewed conch and breads. Let's remember that and support him. Let's bow our heads together in this moment, please. May grace, mercy, and peace of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be with each of us and all of us today and always. And the people of God said,